Hi there, guys. Sitting up my balcony again, drinking some coffee with cream, as usual. And was going to talk about a little bit about this, you know, NLP stuff, neuro linguistic programming, for those who don't know. And there's some traffic going on, as usual. I hope my sound dampening works a little bit better than last time, and that you can pick me up clearly. A lot of people, when they have a problem, whatever that might be for them, have a contextual reality, right? A contextual reality is built up by having a particular position or an experience. Once you have that kind of experience for a while, the comparisons you have, knowing that you're inside this kind of contextual reality, more or less go out of your awareness. And for many, they don't know how they, what kind of experience they're running until they expose themselves to some kind of counter, so they understand. Like say if you read in a magazine and you read something about what people are doing in the world, and you go like, why do you do that? Because it's a counter to your belief system or reality. This is not how things should be, for example. Then you know that you have something going on in the background that you're not aware of, but produced the experience of. So every experience people have a comparison somehow. But since the comparison goes away, we don't know how many, you know, what kind of experience we have. It's like riding a bike or ice skating or driving a car. You did learn that, but recalling how that was, you know, learned, most people can't remember, recall what was going on while they were learning the ice skating, driving the car or something like that. All they know today is that they can drive a car. They can ice skate, they can, you know, do things, but they can't recall what was going on at the time. That's how the brain works. The brain works by adapting and adjusting to the contextual environment you're engaged into. For example, when I moved to my new apartment, it took me about 3 months before my system had adjusted to the apartment, and I knew that, wow, I've lived here all my life. It's only been 3 months, and I had a hard time recalling the last 10 years in the old place. And this is always going on, so the brain is always constructing reality as an ongoing process. The memory we have about, you know, things that was going on, oh yeah, I can recall that, and you know, it's always a construction. So even when we think we understand and can recall things exactly as they were, most of the times that's a construction that might be correct, but it's not sure about if this is actually correct. So that, I mean, the police knows about this when they have a witness. Because when they interview witness for an event, they will have all kind of different, you know, scenarios going on. They have no real, you know, a witness. It's like you see in a TV show, for example. What did you do back in the 12th of December, 1977? You know, I can't recall what I was doing, you know, 2 weeks ago. Maybe if there was a specific accident that happened or an incident that happened at the time around me or next door or something like that, maybe I can recall, but I won't recall the date. So when I'm watching TV shows, I go like, you know, how do those guys do that? How can you recall such a date and, you know, time, what I was doing at the time? So we try to get a sense of, you know, contextuality, whatever. So what do people do in NLP? Well, what they do in NLP is try to change your contextual reality, the one you, you know, have. And it won't work that well. Robert Dills, for example, picked up a girl on stage back in 1988. He did his thing with NLP to help her stop smoking. She was attending the workshop he was doing or something like that. So. It worked for 2 weeks. After 2 weeks, he started smoking again. And for about 8 years, he complained about that, you know, failed attempt by Robert Dills. that he couldn't help her, you know, stop smoking. She did, however, trained herself in LP and as a nurse practitioner and all that. And one day I told her that I wanted to do something and picked her up on stage. And it was a small few things that happened was going on before that. But I did clear up everything she had about that kind of a man. She still smoked at the time. She came back when I was doing a 2-day workshop, told me that she was smoking. I said, I don't care about that. I didn't want to do anything about the smoking. I wanted to do anything about her, you know, complaining about this for 8 years. And this is what's going on when you try to change the contextual reality from within, and you apply a pattern or a technique or a process. As I've been teaching people now, if you have a phobia, you use the phobia cure, and you don't ask yourself, especially if the client is telling you, I have a phobia, and then you apply the phobia cure and it doesn't work, and they go like, why doesn't it work? It should work. But you didn't do the information gathering, and people go, what do you mean by information gathering? Well, you have to understand what's going on inside this, you know, contextual reality people have. Well, why should I do that? But because that's included in NLP. That's the kind of, you know, information gathering protocol. And people go, well, what's that? That doesn't sound like fun. And I go, no, it's not fun. But it's needed to know to understand what's going on. And some people say, what do you mean by that? What? In Whisper in the Wind, it's a book by John Grinder and Carmen. John Grinder gave an example. He was working with a client, a lady. She had cancer. And during the session, she said that to cure the cancer in somehow, she had to have her world turned upside down. And so he didn't do anything. He just thought up a good, example. Called a friend and arranged that the lady went there to buy an airplane for him for payment. She couldn't pay. So she did, ask the question to the pilot and all that stuff. And then when she was done and get the information gathering, she was going to leave. And the pilot said, where are you going? Well, I'm leaving to tell John Grinder this information he asked about. And the pilot told her, if he's going to, buy an airplane, he wants to try it out. So without any further ado, she was in the pilot, in the plane with the pilot. And he was an acrobatic pilot flyer. And whatever was going on inside of her, the new upside down in a plane, it's kind of a world turned upside down. Now, it was kind of elaborate, funny. You can have the kind of resource, you can do something like that. But he could at least, put some kind of machine and turn her upside down in the office also. Should have worked as well. This is the world upside down. People, she will go, oh. And she would be, her cancer went away, by the way, by the example of the airplane. And so people go, can you cure cancer that way? No. Because it's not about curing the cancer. This is about making the individual heal themselves. In that case, it worked. It doesn't work that way all the time, depending on how the cancer was, If it's you're stressed all the time, and you fix the stress, maybe the cancer goes away. Maybe not. So some people, they have an expectation because they have done things and all that stuff. Anyway, so NLP, they lie to you because they change. You can work within the contextual reality you have, right? I have a problem, right? Or you can ask a new question. So when I have a client say, I go like, well, I have a problem with that and that. They say to me, okay, I'm fine with that. I say, so what do you want? And I could ask. And they go like, well, I would want that, which is fine and dandy. Or I can ask them, so what's it like in the future when this stuff works with life, most likely? They go like, what do you mean? When life is working for you? Well, I have this problem, I understand that, I don't care about that. And I just want to know when life starts to work for you. What's that like? And most of the time that takes a fair bit of elicitation before they can start to answer the kind of question. Before they can, when life works for me. And the thing here is, when you ask a question like that, what's life when it works for you? That's a causality question. That's a question that includes action of causality or cause effect or a behavioral action included in that. So to answer that question, you arrive at the same thing I was starting out with. Is you arrive at that you can ride a bike, or you can, you know, ice skate, or you can drive a car. You can throw a frisbee or whatever. You just understand, oh, this is how I can do that. How did I learn to do that? I don't know. This is the same thing, right? So the client tells me all this stuff, and I say, so what's life on this work field? Until they can answer me on that. But then here is the kicker. When they can answer me, the all, whatever what's going on, the position, the experience, the memory, the problem, whatever, it doesn't exist anymore. It just goes away because it's contained in different contexts. And people go like, can you do that? Yes. So you don't need to solve anything. You don't need to, you know, fix anything inside the context, as they do in NLP, as in psychology, as in any other change technology out there. You need to learn to understand that if you shift context, it's like my sister's husband. When he's stressed out, he goes to the garage. When he goes out to the garage, he's fine. You know, he can clean the garage. He can, you know, redecorate his tools or something like that. He can do a lot of things, but he's not stressed out then. For him, that's his, you know, peace of mind place. But that's also external, it's contained in the environment. So what I'm trying to teach people is to take that kind of, you know, serenity he has inside the garage, to have that serenity when he's interacting with his family, when he's interacting with his job, when he's interacting with a friend, when he goes shopping. So he has built an internal context when this experience is running all the time. So instead of, you know, altering it or get stressed out because there's a lot of things going on in the family, he go like, oh, serenity all the time. Yeah, and people do that everywhere in the world. Not that many, but people learn to do that. So when NLP try to change a problem or change a pattern or change a phobia, change the anxiety, whatever it is, you will always run into problem because it will not work unless you know exactly what to do. Because when every time when it does work, there's always a shift in context. Always. For example, people know about the Richard Bandler torpedo therapy. He's using language to shift representations. Well, that's what people understand. What he's actually doing is shift the context the individual is interacting from. When they shift the context, the problem goes away. And if you have a great rapport and a great language skill, you can move those kind of, you know, reference points for people so they can have a, you know, new reference and they go, I don't know, fine now. Just like that. And that's, you know, the power of NLP if you want to, but most people don't understand NLP in that way. Most people understand it is a pattern to apply, especially in the change world. You have a lot of other things in NLP that's really great. But I mean, the NLP field is about, you know, study of the human subjective experience and doing modeling about excellence. And I assume when you do that, that you also want to have a feedback loop to the field itself, that the field itself get more excellent over the years. So over 30 years, you have a field that's basically geniuses all the time. Right? People are, you know, trained to get to genius level. And I don't see that happening. I mean, my students are, when they are trained, they are able to do what I consider the important piece. They can't even have a client or work as a coach or have a, you know, another member of the human race talking to them. They can do things. They can help them alter their perception. We can help them fixing their life in order. It's like this lawyer, you know, sitting down with a client who has alcohol, living on the street, stuff like that. Have six people screaming stuff at him. Talks to him for about 20 minutes and all the voices goes away and he can sit down and talk to him, in, you know, as a client. And there's no psychologist I know about who could do that. But he's a lawyer, he could, you know. He was telling me a lot of other cool stuff he was doing. It was really amazing how he used the material to get. I have this lady in South Sweden, she's a teacher. And her husband had rheumatoid, and I helped him, went to my class, so he doesn't have rheumatoid anymore. At least in his life, because he had to stop taking medication, all that stuff. He had the Becherev disease, it's 20 years, and that's a chronic disease, it doesn't get any better. It didn't get better. And now, she took the material I was teaching, that applied it in schools, what she was doing that whenever two kids were fighting, she took them and asked them about what they were going to do next. She didn't ask them about what she was, whose fault it was, who did the wrong thing, because they always blame each other, because the kids are what they do. They do what the kids, the teachers and the parents and all those people trying to teach them to do, who's to blame, who started the fight. She didn't care about it. She goes, well, okay, I don't care. So the kids, she hold them, and she, the kids started, it was his, he started, and she said, I don't care about what you're going to do next. And she waited until they could give her a good answer. Well, I'm going to go play with the sandbox, or I'm going to go play with Ulle or something, you know, another, you know, kid. Okay, she let them go. No punishment. She said, after 3 weeks, all the kids started, I've gone from arguing, fighting, conflicts all over the fucking place, you know, to just being fine. There was a lot more harmony because she taught the kids to think ahead. What are you going to do next? Not what you have done or are doing, but what are you going to do next? If she was doing that, as a consequence, as she just did that for 3 weeks. After 3 weeks, the kids had picked up on that paragraph. So they started to, when they did something that didn't work, what am I going to do next? Now, I tell this guy, he's a golfer in South Sweden also. I tell this guy about this, you know, lady of mine, student of mine, what she was doing in school. And he was like, you know, could that work? So he had this kid. He was really upset in the morning. His mother went away to work. So he's sitting, you know, he was really, you know, and he, my girlfriend, right, looks at him and said, well, you're upset right now, but what are you going to do now, next? He stood there for 5 seconds, went like this, went up and played with his toys. Not pissed off anymore. And he was like, you know, that's kind of funny. It did work. Because a lot of people, when they have kids, you know, they have no education about it. Well, they have education about sex and stuff like that, but they don't have no real education about how to raise kids, you know. Because they're most likely trying to do the best in any way they can. And most likely they're stressed out by work and economy and global warming. Just, you know, it's a lot of stuff to get worried about out there. So the question is, how do we get people then to raise the kids in a way that works? Well, teach them about whatever happens right now, whatever's happened in the past, doesn't matter, because whatever you're doing next, that's what really counts. And some people talk about the trajectory of intent, stuff like that, like how you are on the way to somewhere, you know, in life, there I'm going there, right? And they have all this kind of expression in the body, where they're going, I'm going there, you know, all that stuff. That's all fine and dandy. Thing here is that when you're trying to do things as an intent or whatever it is, it's a shift in context. So you're thinking whatever's going to work ahead of time. So you're taking that, that's going to work at time. You establish that as an experience and a contextual reality, so you understand this is what I want to happen, this is what I want it to be. And people go, does that work all the time? Yes. Sometimes right away, sometimes it takes some time. For example, it took me about a little bit more than 2 years to get the golf swing and the golf game to the level I wanted to be. It took me 7 months of the last 7 months to get my golf swing into where I understand how my body must move. But when I'm now today, I'm able to move the body the way it needs to be moved to meet my criteria of what I wanted to be. It's my game. And my swing and stuff in golf has met my criteria of what I wanted to happen 2 years ago. So it took about a little bit over 2 years. And I did things over those 2 years that I had never done before. So people ask me, how do you know what to do? I didn't. You see, this is the fate portion of the experience. You decide wherever you want to go, wherever you want to end up. You list the kind of experience, wow, that experience is really good. To have a life like this, you know, that would be, oh man, that would be, you know, there's no words to express it. And you know, most people just sit there, you know, if I can have this forever, I'll go like, can I have that? It's a iconic experience, you can always have that. it will have a variation in degree of your own respect. Most people, when they are exposed to the environment, their life, you know, their normal life, kids, school, work, good friends, who really want your best, by the way. They tell you how, with great support and love, that will never work with you. You will suck at it, whatever it is. That's to your good friends. They're really there for you, to support you and rally you to success. Don't do that, mate. It will work. You will crash and burn. That's a really good friend, by the way. Real support and love. That won't work. So you have to decide to make decision that, do you want people like that around you? Do you want people that are really, you know, badass idiots, stupid, stuff like that? Or do you want to have support with friends? So you make a decision along the way that I want this, or I don't want that, or this is what I really want. And you start doing more things that's in line with whatever you want things to be. Because if you don't do that, you will still be in your own wheel of fortune, your own contextual reality. And whatever you try to do with willpower and reading books and tapes and watching tapes and all that stuff won't happen, because it will still be inside the same contextual reality. So you have to shift context. You have to shift it. Establish a new one, new reference. Because it doesn't matter if you're doing it for 40, 50 years. Once you're able to shift context, whatever has been true for you, that's how the brain works. Because whenever you establish a new context, the brain goes, what's going to be inside this context? Because once you establish a new context, you can establish whatever kind of, you know, experience references you want to have, because the brain is always coordinating or organizing whatever your operating procedure, whatever you call it, because it's physical things in the brain. So the same information that you have had for, you know, years and years and years, suddenly it's not, you know, the same anymore. So people go like, what's going on? Well, once you shift context, whatever was in the old context, it doesn't follow. It doesn't connect, because that's the physical thing about the brain. It's not in the same position, because how the brain works is to understand your... It's a position system. If you talk about GPS, your phone or a car, you have a GPS signal. You have a GPS wherever you go in the world. The signal is sent to a satellite, and you can pinpoint your location with about, I don't know, 2 yards, 3 yards, I don't know. And the brain works in a similar way, that has a position related to context. So once you understand that, when you're accessing a particular experience in context, once you keep that running, that whatever happens in the world will, you know, try to affect and influence that in some way, unless you understand how it works, how you establish that, so you can, you know, reset it if you want, or reboot it if you like. Or you just keep doing the same decisions because it's in line with your experience. But doing it as NLP does, it basically sucks. I mean, it's not... It's required, if you do it that way, by the way, it requires a lot of skills. So I'm trying to teach people, when I was doing my workshop, I'm teaching them one criteria of doing NLP that will always work. No one else out there in the world is teaching that. Not Richard Bandler, not John Grinder, not Robert Dills, not David Gordon, not Delosi, not any name, just Rick included, doesn't teach that. They don't know what that is. And I won't tell you. Maybe some other YouTube tape, I'll put it out there, I don't know. We'll see. See, I found that, you know, when I'm doing my work, I'm analyzing behaviors, I'm analyzing patterns. And it's not about the internal experience of a lot, it's a lot about the, you know, what's going on the outside. So you have to create an iconic experience so you're able to view the world in its own beauty. Otherwise, you're always inside your own head, as people like to say. I'm always inside your head, you know. So how do you get from, you know, all this comparison people do normally, representation, all this stuff, until to, you know, explore the world? You can't do that from the kind of position people normally have. You need to elicit the new contextual reality when this experience is like it is. Hold that kind of reference point, operate that and organize in that way. Then when you engage into the, you know, well, job, work, company, I don't know, creating a new company, invention, whatever, running family, whatever, then you're open to whatever information is out there. Because then you're running a stable, a common experience. Then you can engage to whatever things is out there, identify with it, and, you know, explore the beauty and freshness of life. And then you go back to your own experience again and go like, oh yeah, this is, you know, great. Then you can identify whatever environment context you're engaged into, and then go back to running your own experience. You can do it that way, or you can try to change your own experience all the time and try to fix things inside your contextual reality. Instead, what I recommend, build new information, new context, new experiences. And working with, you know, this kind of RBIM, Interflow, working with Interflow, and after your joints, you know, moves a little bit smoother. You feel younger and feel more flexible and more mobile. You can do this. And it's all about your focus and attention to produce this kind of effect. Because when you can start being able to do that, the step to start, you know, understanding and calibrating or becoming aware of your own experience in any time when you're, you know, having the experience becomes much, much easier. Because you're responsible for your own experience. So you understand, you need to understand how it interacts. And you are the one who needs to be doing it, not me. Anyway, I'm just babbling about a little bit about this, you know, contextual reality people have. Obviously, when you have a problem, you have it. This is real, right? But the point here is, since the brain is always doing ongoing construction, the problem has to, you know, continue for a long time. If you have the problem for 3 weeks or 3 years or 50 years, the brain has to produce that as an ongoing experience. It's always happening right now. People go, well, what do you mean? Well, if the problem has to be 3 weeks, it can't be, because then you have to produce it every time the same way. And people go, yeah, but if you had the problem once, why should you be able to do it over and over and over again? That's the brain doing this ongoing construction. So for people who had, you know, a traumatic experience in the childhood, you go like, and I said, well, if it happens once, why should it happen all over again, right? And people said, well, that's, you know, the memory. It's the ongoing construction of the present moment. Once you change context, that doesn't happen anymore. I had clients who had problems for 5, 10, 15, 20 years. I had a client who had problems since they were 2 years old. And age 19, they had this horrible problem now because it was all their life. Start talking to me, things starting to happen. Change the context, sooner or later they start, you know, moving away from home. Things going on in their lives, and suddenly, you know, their life starts to work, and they go like, what's going on? And they had NLP people working with them before me, or psychologists, and stuff like that. And I said, well, I understand that you need to shift context. I couldn't explain that back in, you know, 10 years ago. That's what's going on. You know, when you change context and you start telling people how this works, it's really easy to understand, for even for a beginner. So you don't need to be an academic trained professional, or, you know, doing 5 day NLP practitioner. You can learn this in a day, 2 hours, something like that. They go, oh, okay, I understand that. So if I shift my context, this will happen, yes. So they shift the context, and sooner they go like, you know, this feels, you know, like, this feels normal. People go like, yes, and it doesn't feel like a change. And I know, because you haven't changed anything, you have shifted context. Since you shift context, there's no change neither. People talk about, you know, identity and I have to change myself to, you know, really be successful. And I go like, you don't need, if you shift the context, then you don't need to ask that kind of question, because that kind of question don't need to be asked, because then you will have, you know, the experience and stuff like that that will work for you instead of against you. People are like, are you sure about that? Well, it will feel the same but it will be all different. And people go like, what do you mean by that? Well, I took this guy who had a golf swing. I tried to tell him for about 4 years, you have to just change the golf swing. I'm a professional, I've been doing this for 20 years, I know what I'm doing, okay? After 4 years of the same injury, he couldn't play. He finally gave in and said, well, I have to change it, okay. 3 weeks later, he was hitting the ball totally different. 3 weeks. People go like, you can't do that, I didn't change anything. He's doing the same thing he was doing before the change. But his technique and how he hits the ball is totally different. People go like, shouldn't that take 2 years? Yes, if you do it the way the people normally do, but I don't do it that way. And he understands what he was doing. He can't explain today how the change was made, or how the shift or the transformation. He can't tell you that. He can tell you that. If you give him a ball, give him a club, he will hit it down the line, long, long way, straight as an arrow. And he said, I can do this, but I don't understand how I did actually make the transition. That's when you make a smooth transition. That's when you make things work for you. So whatever problem, I will end with this. Whatever problem you have or have had, it's an ongoing construction. Start to shift context, it goes away. You get distracted by something going on in the outside world, you don't have the problem. You shift the context to the external world. If you learn to do that more consistently, you don't have any problems anymore. And I guess that's kind of cool, if you ask me. Pretty awesome, some will say. And I grind my own coffee, by the way. I have a coffee bean and I grind that before in the morning, so my coffee is more, you know, fresh. It's a little bit about quality of life. So, if you have any questions, comments, things you want to know about, whatever it is, NLP, psychology, RBIM, with yourself, my point of view of stuff, if you want to hear it, you ask the question. Don't want to hear, don't ask, don't comment. I will still keep doing this, you know, webinars or YouTube or whatever you call them. And I will might to aid some, you know, concrete information, because a lot of things that I'm doing is really simple, but people can't, you know, say that it can't be this simple, and I say it is that simple, because when you do it, it's shifting context. But to get people to shift context, that takes a lot of work of them, because you have to work with the logic of, you know, do you really want this kind of, you know, desired future when things work? And they go like, yeah, I really want, but you know, it's, you know, how it is. And this is the same thing when people listen to this tape and try to, you know, make a conclusion, or that you try to compare whatever you know with what I've been telling you here in the other tapes, or in my blog. You take whatever I'm trying to teach you, for other people, and then you apply it to your own reference and information and all that stuff, and try to make up your mind about it, instead of just, you know, go with the flow. Back in 2003, when I entered Joseph's two-day program, at the time I was one of three people who had run his model through in the first exposure. I didn't go into a workshop like that and what's going on here? You know, show the coil crusade of what's dangerous here, I guess. He's doing something cool, hit me. And at the time I was one of three people. The other two at the time was David McDermott and the Danish guy, I can't remember, I call his name, I'm so tired sometimes of your names. And he runs Meet Yourself programs in Denmark and NLP and stuff like that. And at the time, probably some other people had done. Most people, you know, whenever they do things in life, are more focused on changing things because that makes more sense for them. But that takes a lot of work, a lot of time, often complicated. Start to shift context in the future. Okay, but it hasn't happened yet, but it will happen. I want to make it happen. I'm starting to think about that, elicit that. Sooner or later, the brain starts to produce that. That's an ongoing construction step. So you feel like, you know, I've always done that. It's like I told you in the beginning. When I moved to the apartment, it took me 3 months without doing anything before my brain accepted this is my new, you know, reference point in my environment. And then I felt like I've been living here forever. I could down that faster also, not naturally. I could take it more time also. But I wanted to check to see how long does it take before I get this, you know, idea in my head that I've been living here forever. It's still been just 3 months. And this is the same thing with problems that people have. When you shift context, it becomes the same thing. This is what I've always been doing, because the brain is always then constructing a new reality, a new context to reference. So if you've been smoking for 30 years, you start doing this, shift context, you've never been smoking, you have this, you know, ongoing thing. And for you, it will feel like you have always done that and not been a smoker and stuff like that. But my identity as a smoker, well, that doesn't follow. You don't change that either, whatever. If you understand this contextual stuff, you don't change yourself. There's no need to change yourself in any way, because if you shift the context, you will formulate a new identity that, you know, be supported by a new action. Either it is starting a company, making an invention, not smoking anymore, having a fun, being a lot more happier, more content with life, serenity, you know, in the flow, in the zone, and go with the flow, go with the same world. Some people say, well, it's better that you talk than you sing, and dancing we can accept, but singing, not so much. Anyhow, I'm just, you know, talking about some stuff I've been doing and still do for about 20 years. Till next time.